Our next speaker I'm going to ask is the London Center's president, Herb London, for his remarks. Herb?
It is a great pleasure to be with you, and I would be very remiss if I didn't point out that my dear friend Bud McFarlane is with us today, former National Security Advisor to Ronald Reagan, and Bud for joining us. There are lots of things that I want to say, but first let me tell you a little story. The story is appropriate for Louis Gohmert before he leaves. There are three very important lessons in life a wise man once told me about. One is never to climb a wall that leans towards you, never to kiss a woman that leans away from you, and never speak after Louis Gohmert. Now, that's a big problem. Because Congressman Gohmert has, I think, covered this area very well indeed. But let me point out a couple of things that were not mentioned during the course of his presentation. The first is that the Muslim Brotherhood has had ties to hate organizations from its very beginning in 1928. There were ties to the Nazis in the 1930s, some of you will recall. There was the funding of Al-Qaeda. The first funding of Al-Qaeda came from the Muslim Brotherhood. And then in addition, we now see the Muslim Brotherhood has ties to ISIS. So when we talk about the Muslim Brotherhood, we're talking about an organization that has been involved with terrorism since its origins in the late 1920s. The other point that I would like to make is that when Mubarak fell, that was the first revolution, there were two revolutions in recent times in Egypt, but when Mubarak fell, there was no organization that could follow politically. As a consequence, the Muslim Brotherhood was organized, did run Morsi. Morsi, you may remember, said, "I will never run for president." Well, he did run for president, and he was elected. As a consequence, there are people in our State Department who believe that because he was elected democratically, we should support him. The consequence of that is that there was a charm campaign organized by our State Department that had Muslim Brotherhood members travel the country and suggest that they were really quite moderate, very much interested in the United States, very willing to deal with minorities in their own country, including the Catholic population, and so an impression was created. This was very interesting because I went to a Council of Foreign Relations meeting where there were five of the most attractive people I've ever seen in my life who were seated in front of me. They were called the members of the Muslim Brotherhood. Each one wore a $500 suit. The young lady who was there looked like a young Merle Oberon. very attractive woman wearing a scarf on her head. It was a Prada scarf. They were outfitted perfectly. They came right out of Central Casting. And the impression was created, these are reasonable people to deal with. Now what the Egyptians told the world is that they are not so easy to deal with. And after a year, you have the second revolution with 33 million Egyptians on the streets of Egypt. And what those, there are 90 million people in the country. One-third of that population was on the streets of Egypt, demonstrating against Morsi. And Al-Sisi was a man who became a hero because Morsi said, "Fire on those demonstrators." He refused to do so. As a consequence, he became a national hero. And, of course, later elected president of the country. But the one thing that people overlook, and to which we have given scant attention, Al-Sisi gave a speech at Al-Azhar roughly a year and a half ago. That speech was very interesting because he said we have violence within our religion. And at the end of it, he used the words, "We need a revolution from within." Now, one might have assumed when a speech of that kind is given that it would be embraced by the President of the United States and by every American. It was given scant attention. Aside from a one-inch reproduction in the Wall Street Journal, I could not find an editorial anywhere in the United States that paid attention to Al-Sisi's speech. It was a little like Martin Luther's speech talking about the 95 Theses, challenging his own religion to deal with the questions of militancy and extremism. And that was, in my judgment, a remarkable moment that we should have seized on. If you want to deal with people who want to kill you, one of the ways to deal with them is to say, let's find those within the religion, pious Muslims, who are eager for some kind of systematic change. Al-Sisi was that person, is that person. And it seems to me that more should be done in the United States to give attention to that effort. It is also a great danger. So we no longer recognize an enemy that is within. It is now seen as a legitimate voice of the Muslim people. It is not a legitimate voice. It's an extremist voice. And what we have done at the London Center is not only spend time on this, but we have a new book that I urge you to get on Amazon, only $15, excuse me for the commercial pitch. It's called The Encyclopedia of Militant Islam, which deals with 44 of the major terrorist groups in the world and what they are attempting to accomplish. Now, in general, we know what they want to accomplish. The caliphate, of course, the introduction of Sharia, the use of jihad as a methodology. But what we do not know are the tactics of individual organizations, where they exist, what kind of funding they get. And that is incorporated into this book so that we can start to understand who the enemy is and what we have to do. Now, there's often the question, what does the United States have before it? It has an enormous challenge. It has a challenge that in some ways is unprecedented, but not completely. People forget that we are fighting a war not only on the battlefield, not only with guns and bullets, we are fighting an ideological war against this radical Islamic threat. And how do you fight that kind of war? Well, you're not only fighting by being on the battlefield and being successful and not providing people with a safe zone. We also fight it on an ideological front. And we have a template for it. It was called the Cold War. We fought communism not only in the battlefield in Korea, not only in the battlefield in Vietnam, we fought it with ideas. And we are capable of resurfacing that same playbook again. And let me tell you what's in that playbook. There are logistics, there's intelligence, penetration of the enemy, clandestine officers, and dirty tricks. There are cultural activities, all within the framework of fighting against an enemy. There's ridicule, all in the name of fighting this threat. When I went to Eastern Europe years ago, towards the end of the fall of the Communist Empire, I remember chatting with people in university, and if you asked the question, are you a Marxist-Leninist, they would all laugh. Because at that point, it was ridicule. Marxism, Leninism, are you kidding? It was gone. We have to do the same thing with radical Islam. Make the case that it is absurd. If you want to leave this world in a box, we have a way for you to do that. But it's important for the United States to understand this is a threat. This is a long war, and it's a war that is not only fought on a battlefield, it's fought in our educational institutions, it's fought in our cultural institutions, and it's fought with our intelligence community. We are not doing that at the moment. This is the challenge. It's not only a challenge for you, it's not only a challenge for today, it is a challenge for the generation, because this too is a long war, a generational war, and we can win it. The playbook is clear. We know what we have to do. The challenge is, when do we start? Thank you very much.